Hi, I'm Nick, and I'm a motion designer on the SysUI team. We're here to talk to you about the Android back button and gesture navigation. Firstly, let's talk about how back evolved to understand the context of the change we're introducing. Home, recents, and back have been key actions within Android for navigation, both within your app and between different apps. It first started as a hardware button and evolved through the software back button to become gesture navigation. The current approach requires no buttons, which frees up screen real estate. While we provide seamless animations for going home and entering recents, we don't yet do this for back. Our goal is to make back as intuitive. Android 13 marks the beginning of a multi-year investment in gesture navigation to make it more predictable and user-friendly. As part of this, we're updating the on-screen affordance and improving haptics to give a consistent feel across the system. User research shows that people are most frustrated when system back unexpectedly returns them to the launcher, forcing them to reopen the app. As a result, the first changes we are making are designed to improve this experience. API updates are planned for this release, with prominent system improvements following soon after. However, we cannot provide users with these new interactions without your help. When users perform gestures to go home or open recents, the system knows what is happening ahead of time. This allows us to give intuitive feedback during the gestures themselves. When the user initiates a back gesture, the system doesn't know whether the app is handling it. As a result, a suitable feed forward cannot be displayed. Starting at Android 13, apps should tell the system in advance if they will be handling back events. This supports a new ahead of time model for dispatching system back. The system knows ahead of time, before the gesture starts, if an application is handling system back. When this is not the case, the system knows to take control and display feedforward hints. If we apply this to our back-to-home example, knowing ahead of time allows the system to preview the app dismiss, revealing the launcher behind. To do this, the system needs to know whether the next back action will be popping the in-app backstack or returning to the launcher. As a result of these changes, users will see what they are doing ahead of time, allowing them to prevent false actions. Now I'm going to hand it over to Sean, who will explain how to adopt these changes.
Amazing. Thank you, Nick. Hi, I'm Sean, and I'm a software engineer on the System UI team. To support this ahead of time model, we're introducing a new API called OnBackInvoked Callback, which will be the cornerstone of the predictive back navigation. This interface has one main method, onBackInvoked, which will be called instead of the legacy onBackPress methods from your activities and dialogues. We will also stop sending keyEvent.keyCallback to applications using the new behavior. To register one of these callbacks, you need to get an onBackInvoked dispatcher from activity or dialogue. Once you have an instance of the dispatcher, you can register a callback. In doing so, you're telling the system ahead of time that your code wants to handle system back. This way, when back navigation happens, your code will be called and the system will do nothing else. On the other hand, if you do not provide a callback or unregister your callback, the system will take control and play these peaking animations and will close your activity or dialogue when the gesture or button press finishes. To use this API, you need to adapt your app to this new world of system back. In Android 13, we ask apps to explicitly opt in to this new behavior. Until you opt in, you won't be affected at all. So the first thing to do is add enable onBackInvoked equals true in the application tab of your Android manifest. That is all you need if you don't provide custom back navigation in your app. Note that with Android 14, the legacy behavior will entirely be replaced by the ahead-of-time approach. This flag also allows you to opt in early, even before you target Android 13. This is helpful if you want to verify that your back behavior will work correctly on an Android 13 device without opting into every single change in Android 13. We recommend that you use the Android X Activity Library and upgrade it to version 1.6. With this update, libraries like Android X Fragments, the navigation component, and usages of Backhandler in Jetpack Compose are all instantly made compatible with Android 13 while still being backwards compatible with the previous versions of Android. And that is all thanks to the ahead-of-time model Android X Activity already had in its on-by-press dispatcher API. Each component activity and its subclasses in Fragment Activity and App Compat Activity has an on-by-press dispatcher. The dispatcher automatically calls your activity's on-by-press method when you target previous versions of Android. But on Android 13 and later, it will call the new platform APIs. We have recently expanded this to dialogs as well with a component dialog class, which also has its own on-by-press dispatcher that takes precedence when the dialog is visible. The duty of on-by-press dispatcher is to maintain the set of callbacks that want to handle system back and find and dispatch the back signal to the right callback. There are two main styles of using these callbacks. The first is to add your callback as part of the creation of your component and using the isEnabled flag to turn the callback on and off as the state of your component changes. This style ensures that the nested components are always added in the same order and therefore are always considered by the dispatcher in the same order. The dispatcher will just skip over any layer that aren't enabled yet. This also ensures that the innermost component gets popped before the outer layers. The other way to use this callback is for temporary overlays. In this case, you'd wait to add your callback until all of your enable conditions are met. Notice that this breaks out of the default nested case by ensuring that your callback is always the last one added. This could be useful for example, a contextual action bar. Let's go through a more complicated example with multiple callbacks. Let's say that you're using the navigation component with fragments to handle your backstack. Here, your nav controller does have a backstack, so its internal callback is enabled. Each fragment has its own child fragment manager and could have a backstack, but we're not using them yet, so it is disabled. Our topmost fragment is an entry form and really doesn't want users to lose their data. So, it registered a callback specifically to open a "Are you sure you want to cancel the submission" dialog. The callback is disabled by default because the user hasn't typed anything yet. If a user tries to go back now, the navigation controller is the topmost enabled callback and just takes the user back without any dialog interruption. But once the user has started typing something, the fragment callback is enabled, and now it would receive the callback for system back. The code in that topmost fragment for adding the callback is straightforward. We get the dispatcher from the activity, and then we add the callback. We provide a lifecycle owner, here the fragment's lifecycle owner, that ensures the callback will only be triggered when the fragment's lifecycle is started and will automatically be unregistered when the lifecycle is destroyed, preventing any memory leaks. The trailing lambda is what is called to handle system back and where we show our dialog. Note that we passed in false for the default enable state. Because remember, for our case, we only want to interrupt when the user have started typing something. And that is where the do after text change listener comes in, updating our isEnable state when the text becomes non-empty. If you have already started converting your app to Compose, things are even easier for you, as all of the on-by-press dispatcher API has been wrapped into a single backhandler API that is part of the activity Compose artifact. Jetpack Compose takes care of adding and removing the callbacks for you. All you need to do is control whether your backhandler is enabled and to implement your callback. Again, both this code and the fragment code work on both Android 13 devices and older devices once you upgrade Android X Activity to 1.6. The Android Axe Activity APIs give you a backward compatible way to hook into the platform APIs and will continue to be the future-proof way to get new features as we expand our work around predictive back. If you are overriding OnBack Prest in your activity, you can start migrating that code into callbacks right now and test the migration completely independently from moving to Android 13. The Android Axe Activity APIs give you those higher-level hooks to handle system back, but your apps might also have lower-level components, such as custom views that are currently intercepting key callback to handle back. To move those lower-level components to an ahead-of-time model, you'll need to use the platform APIs directly. Let's take a look at drawer layout and how we integrated it using the new platform APIs. To support pre-Android 13 devices, drawer layout overrides views onKeyDown and onKeyUp methods to handle system back. For views like drawer layout, even this wasn't always enough. The view needs to be the currently focused view to receive key event dispatches, which wasn't always the case. This noticeably isn't a problem for the new platform APIs. You'll see that in the onKeyUp code, there are two properties that control whether drawer layout actually wants to handle system back, whether the drawer is currently visible, and whether the lock mode is unlocked. These are the signals that we need to migrate to the ahead-of-time model. First, at the class level, we'll create a framework onBack invoke callback that will call closeDrawers method when it is invoked. We'll also create a separate flag that keeps track of if we have already registered our callback with the framework. Next, we'll create a method that registers and unregisters our callback based on the current state. This is the method that we'll call ahead of time, right when our state changes, rather than waiting for the back signal to be fired. We compare our new register state with the old register state and call register or unregister. This ensures our view's internal view of the world is always in sync with framework's view of the world. Lastly, we call our update callback state when the state changes. For example, when we start dragging that drawer open or when the lock mode changes. And with that, we're done. Our drawer layout now supports the new ahead-of-time APIs in Android 13. We don't have to touch the onKeyDown or onKeyUp code. The existing code will continue to be called on previous versions of Android or when you opt out. And with that, I'll hand over to Nick to talk about our long-term plans for system back.
Our team has been building out animations for hero use cases, such as the one we show when returning to the launcher. Animations within your application, such as in-app transitions controlled by Jetpack Compose or Fragment Navigation, won't show back previews just yet. However, we're excited to kick off the discussion between designers, developers, and users on how these same types of peaking animations could be applied everywhere. If you want to learn more about System Back and how to migrate your app to Android T, you can check out our code lab. We're also including a developer option so you can test the back-to-home animation on your app. Feel free to reach out to us on Twitter or Reddit if you have any feedback or questions. Thank you for listening.